thorn in the necks of Ahlul Bid'ah. Ubayd al-Jabri said that about Rabi al-Madkhali. He's a thorn in their throats, ya ikhwan. It chokes them.
There is no doubt, ikhwan, that anyone who has observed what has been taking place over the past few years with this fitna of the Musa'ifika and those who are hell-bent on referring to Ahl Sunnah as Sa'afiqa, that their intent is to do nothing, ikhwan, except utilize another tactic to turn the people away from Ahl Sunnah, Al-Haqqa, yani the true Ahl Sunnah, those who, throughout time, the people of hawa and desires have constantly utilized methods and techniques to turn the people away from them. They refer to them as hashwiya. They refer to them as individuals who are yani mutashaddidin, and people who are people of shidda and harshness, or that they are juhal, which is what the term sa'afiqa indicates, or is used to point towards, that these are ignorant people who you shouldn't turn your attention to, juhal, and a people who we should abandon. And of course, at the head of this call in this time is Muhammad bin Hadi, who the people of knowledge have spoken against in a number of gatherings and recordings and audio, clarifying the fact that his statement, and he's referring to some of the people of Sunnah as Sa'afika, is a statement that is based upon dhulm, and is based upon oppression, particularly Sheikhana Sheikh Rabia, that his statement, ikhwan, he reiterates the statement that this is a statement of oppression, and that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said that you should unsur akhaka zaliman aw madhluma, aid your brother oppressed or oppressor. And so the companions, they said, O Messenger of Allah, that any the madhloom, we understand, but how do we aid the zalim? And so the Prophet ﷺ, he said, تَأْخُذُ فَوْقَ يَدِي, yani that you take him by his hand, you stop him from his oppression. And so that was and is what the people of knowledge have attempted to do with this fitna, which is a trial, ikhwan, that has seen the people of Sunnah across the globe being oppressed by, as we mentioned, those who at the head of them is Muhammad ibn Hadi in this recent fitna. And so the intent, therefore, is to turn the people away from Ahl Sunnah. One of the affairs that have risen recently is a statement that has come from Muhammad ibn Hadi and those who are with him, that it is ajib that Muhammad bin Hadi is getting and receiving the type of attention that he's receiving because he spoke against one or two individuals. And when have we ever seen someone make jar of an individual or two and now the dunya falls upon him? And that statement, ikhwan, couldn't be further from the truth. The reality is, as Sheikh Abdullah al-Bukhari and others have mentioned, is that Muhammad bin Hadi has spoken against over 77 of the people of dunya across the people of sunnah across the globe, across the dunya, over 77 in Sudan, in Maghrib, in Libya, in Tunis, in Jazair, in Saudiya, in Mecca, Medina, Jeddah, over 77 of the people of sunnah, and not just the people of sunnah, the best of them, tulab ilm, ahl ilm, people of knowledge and mashaykh, spoken against them, لِمُخَالَفَتِهِمْ لِمَوْقِفِهِ هُوَ, because of the fact that they have opposed him in the position that he has taken, and have declared his position one of oppression, and have declared that speaking against the people of Sunnah without evidence is nothing but dhulm, and is nothing but a path that is utilized by the people of innovation and bid'ah. And as Shaykhana Shaykh Ubaid has mentioned, that he has changed over the past few years. He has changed upon us and has now begun utilizing the asalib and the methods of the people of bid'ah and hizbiyah against the people of sunnah, which is this tanabuz bil alqab, utilizing statements against them to bring them down, to demean them, and to lessen their status. It is an usloob that is not jadeed, but it is gharib to come from someone who was seen as one of the defenders of the sunnah at one stage. And so Ahl al-Ilm have stood together to clarify to the ummah, knowing that it is going to be something that is going to be difficult, a difficult pill for many to accept. But as our brother, Hafidhullah, Abdul Razak, Hamza, he mentioned, these fitan, ayyuhal ikhwa, they are going to occur and reoccur, particularly these types of fitan. And Ahl Sunnah, they are acquainted with the fact that this is going to happen, and this is not going to be the last one. So prepare for the next one. Just as those who went through the fitna of Al-Ma'ribi, through the fitna of Al-Maghrawi, through the fitna of Adnan Ar'ur, through the fitna of Hajori, through the various fitan Halabi, and other than that, they will know that at that time, it was a fitna that many couldn't accept. Now, as Hassan al-Basri mentioned, Al-Fitna ya'rifuha al-ulama, wa ida adbarat ya'rifuha kul'ami. That fitna, when it first occurs, the ulama, they know it. And you have a bunch of juhal running around believing they know it. But then when its tail end appears, every army, every general person, now he understands it. But at the time, the alim who was speaking with basira and ilm, he was being referred to as one who doesn't understand, and one who is jahil, and one who ajib that he would make such a statement, and one who these statements coming from him must be on the basis of those who surround him and are affecting his vision and his outlook and. Or he's become old, as we're now hearing with Sheikh Rabi'a. Kalimat ayuha al-ikhwa ja'ira. Statements that are oppressive. And statements that do not issue except from a person who has no understanding of what is occurring. And the reality is, the majority of those who are flying the flag of Muhammad bin Hadi, if we were to ask them, what is your favorite lecture of Muhammad bin Hadi? What is your favorite book of Muhammad bin Hadi? Akhbirna. يعني لم يكن عندهم جواب. ما يعرفون محمد بن هادي أصلاً ما يعرفونه. The only thing is that they have heard Muhammad bin Hadi is an alim, and now because of the fact that they have an issue with أهل السنة عموماً, those who are either considered affiliates of SBOBs, let's just take the position of those who are against them. So if it was said that Trevor McDonald was an alim that أهل السنة are now speaking against, they would say, يخي, why are you speaking against Trevor? Why you people, subhanAllah, even Trevor? Why? Because the issue isn't so much Muhammad bin Hadi as it is individuals who have a chest piece and an issue in the chest, min zaman. But now this is just another opportunity to make it manifest, or to make their bara'ah and to make the position that they've always had with Ahl Sunnah manifest now to the masses under the guise of, well, these people are speaking against an alim min ulama Ahl Sunnah. Why, ya jama'ah? They wouldn't be able to inform you. Give me 5 minutes on the issue. Explain it to me. Why is Muhammad bin Hadi upon the haq and all of the other ulama, akbar minhu, his teachers, those who are old enough to be his not only father, his grandfather. Wallahi, Shaykhana Shaykh Rabi' is old enough to be his grandfather. Why are they upon batil? And why is he upon the haq? Just give me 5 minutes. Explain it to me. We would hear, because of this tweet, and because of that WhatsApp message, and because of this statement that could have, and perhaps did, and yani maybe, and could have, would have, and should have. Dhunoon, nothing based upon any type of ilm or faham or understanding of the methodology or the manhaj. Purely dhunoon. But why? Because of the fact that actually the issue is not Muhammad bin Hadi. The issue is, here are a group that are opposing. Here are individuals that are opposing those people that we have always had problem with, and we have always had an issue in our hearts with, but now we have an opportunity to manifest that issue under the guise of holding the position of a bona fide scholar from the scholars of Ahl Sunnah. Ikhwan, alhamdulillah, our position, past and present, remains the same. Our position is not one of taqleed. And it is ironic that it would be us who are accused of being muqallidun of Sheikh Rabi' and Sheikh Ubaid and Sheikh Abdullah. But if we were to ask you, what are the evidences then, billahi alaykum, what are the evidences against those who have been referred to? As-sa'afiqa, what would we hear? Inshallah, it's coming. Which is what we've been hearing for the past 2 years. It's coming. Sheikh's going to write something and yakhi, he's going to destroy you. It's coming. There's a malaf al-akhda ila al-an. We're hearing about this green folder that has 300 pages of rad against Arafat and Bandar and everybody else who's been referred to as Sa'afika, 300 pages. Ila al-an. This 300 page rad, which would clear up and finish the issue, has never been issued. Why? Because just as Sheikh and Sheikh Rabi has mentioned, ma indhum wala shay, wala dharrat dalil. Not an ounce, an atom's weight of evidence. This one made a tweet and this one indicated and that one sent out a WhatsApp, which is why in the lecture that Muhammad bin Hadi he delivered, which would ultimately see him in court and now having the judgment, and it is established regardless of what these juhal are running around claiming, of him now having the hukum and the ruling of qadh established upon him, wherein, because of the fact that it was being said to him, ya Sheikh, people are quoting you, referring to these individuals as evil. What is your evidence? And he remained silent for a period because there was nothing to present. And he remained silent because there was nothing to present. And he remained silent because there was nothing to present. Then when he realized that this silence was a problem, he established a lecture and titled it, An al-Waqt. لمحمد بن هادي ليخرج من صماته. The time has now come for Muhammad bin Hadi to come out of his silence. ولا يا ليته خرج أو رجع إليها. If only he would return back to it, because that lecture, number one, did not deal with the issues, which was why is and why are these individuals that you've referred to as evil, like Sheikh Arafat Muhammadi, why is he evil? Why? The whole lecture skated around those individuals that are connected to Arafat, and it was nothing but, again, dhunun and suspicion and things that had no basis. And so he ended up referring to somebody, and one of the individuals who was a witness in the affair concerning some issues, as a fornicator. And now we have a court case that is established. It was appealed twice, and it is now established with no opportunity or chance for further appeal, that he is now considered a qadhif. That is the major sin of qadhf, of falsely accusing a Muslim of zina, is established upon him. From that rule is, number one, his witness will not be accepted again. Number two, that he is considered a fasiq by the hukum of Allah Azza wa Jal. And so, from its ramifications, his removal from the Jami'ah, from the Islamic University, from its ramifications, his inability to further teach, and him being referred to, as occurs in the verses in the Book of Allah, that they are the liars. Which is ironic, since the whole of this mission revolved around wallahi kathabun, kathibat, sa'afika yakthibun, kathib, kathibat, yakthibun. And now, ironically, the very ruling that has now been placed upon him revolves around this fisk and this kadib that he is accusing those individuals of. That they're individuals who feign being scholars, feign being ulama, present themselves as scholars and ulama. But if we were to digress shwaya and we were to look back a number of years, then let us really question. Because when Muhammad bin Hadi came from Riyadh, during the fitna and the days of the fitna of Safar and Salman, one of the accusations that he made in the beginning of this fitna is that just as during the era of Safar and Salman, when I spoke, no one was initially with me, but then they realized I was speaking the truth, and then they came on board and they began to speak, as scholars began to speak against Safar and Salman, in this fitna you will see it will be the same. But what is ironic about that statement is that when Muhammad bin Hadi arrived in Medina, he was in his 20s. Sheikh Rabi said, that is a kadhib, that is a lie. That he was the first one who knew and the scholars didn't know. We knew, but we chose to decide when we were going to speak. And we didn't see that that was the right time at that point to speak. But he initiated that speech without the endorsement of the people of knowledge. But they backed the issue since there was a problem that they had already recognized. But isn't this the exact same thing that you're accusing the Sa'afika of? Young, impressionable youth, believing themselves to be kibar ulama. But here was Muhammad bin Hadi in his 20s speaking against Safwan and Salman, wearing a bish which none of these youth wear, or these younger mashaykh wearing the golden bish. But here we have, in the presence of Al-Albani, Sheikh bin Baz, Sheikh Hamad Al-Ansari, Sheikh Muhammad Amal Al-Jami, we have يعني, a sea, an array of ulama. And here he is, in his 20s, initiating the issue against Safwan al-Salman, who was bigger than any of the individuals that these يعني, so-called Sa'afika have spoken against, or have brought their issue to the people of knowledge. يعني, which is ajeeb. And so, the issue, Ikhwan, it is something that we could speak at length concerning. But the main thing is that we understand first and foremost that the term is an oppressive term. One of the manifestations of its oppression is that the term, Ikhwan, we mentioned previously its linguistic meaning. But the term in and of itself had been used and was a term that was coined by some of the people of knowledge, from the Imam Ibn al-Qayyim, Al-Imam al-Sha'bi, and others, to refer to Mu'attila, who was Juhal. That the Sa'afiqa was a term that was used upon Mu'attila, those who negate the sifat of Allah Azza wa Jal. Thus, when it was being used, and a group from among those who support Muhammad bin Hadi entered upon Sheikh Rabia, the Sheikh said, why are you referring to them as Sa'afiqa? عندهم مشكلات في الصفات. He said, have they got problems with asma and sifat? And so what did they leave saying? Sure, Sheikh is losing it. So as long as they haven't got problems with sifat, they're okay. How many a mubtadi' is perfect in terms of asma and sifat, but elsewhere he has a problem? So they left Sheikh Rabi' saying, subhanallah, look what is happening to the Sheikh. He said, do they have problems in sifat? هذا إن دل على شيء فإنه يدل على إمامة ربيع وجهلكم أنتم. If it indicates anything, then it indicates Sheikh Rabi is an imam, and that أنتم جهال. Since Sheikh Rabi understood that it was a term that was used by the ulama السابقين, the ulama of the past, to refer to مُعَطِّلَ هو جهال, ignorant مُعَطِّلَ, ignorant negators of sifat. Just as the term, as we've mentioned with some of our brothers recently, the Mu'tazila. Mu'tazila aslan, in terms of the logha, is taken from i'tizal, which is to distance oneself from something. It was initially used by those, Amr ibn Ubaid and the Jama'ah, who took that position against the durus of Hassan al-Basri. That they distanced themselves from the durus of Hassan al-Basri. But it was, يعني, developed into a body of principles that they held, ta'til sifat and other than that. And so, the term has now been coined to refer to a particular group of individuals, a particular group of mubtadi'ah. And so if we had a group of brothers who used to come to our lessons, mathalan, and now we don't see them in the masjid anymore, and we start to say, yaqi, when someone asks us, what happened to such and such and such and such, we say, yaqi, them brothers are mu'tazila, yaqi. Mu'tazila. Yeah, they're mu'tazila. Yeah, in Tabi, be careful with them, they're Mu'tazila. What the first thing the brother's going to say is, Allahu Akbar, Mu'tazila. And they wouldn't even know they existed in our time, still the Mu'tazila, Saru Mu'tazila. I mean by the term that they've abandoned our durus, they're making i'tizal of our lessons, and they're making i'tizal of the masjid. But the term in actuality with A'immatul Kubar is a reference to a particular group with a body of belief that are well known with the people of knowledge. And so the term Sa'afika, though it wasn't popularly used, it was used to refer to a particular type and a particular group of individuals. Na'am, ignorance was part of from their characteristics, But ta'til and negation of sifat was similarly from that. And so how is it going to be used against individuals who are ma'rufin, well known to be Salafis, well known to be people of Sunnah? We're going to run around and call them now Sa'afiqa. A term that was used against Ahlul Bid'ah. A term that was used against individuals who made ta'til and sifat. And then in addition to that, we're going to say Iyakum wal-Sa'afiqa. Stay away from them. Ya'ani, they are mulhaquna bi ahlul bid'ah. They are to be coupled and likened with the people of innovation. Don't take from them. Don't sit with them. Don't listen to them. The ahkam and the rulings of Hajar, which is applied to the mubtadi in its asl. And so we're going to give them a bid'i name. We're going to give them the ahkam of the mubtadi'ah. And these are all people of sunnah. And we're going to say it's only one of two, one or two, when in actuality it's over 77. And then we're going to say, Yahi, we're waiting for the scholars to decide what's going to happen in the affair. It's an issue that the scholars have done dealt with the affair, barakallahu feek. And it is only those who have or believe there is something to cling on to, because we actually don't want to, after we've now made a fool of ourselves, holding on to that which has no origin, no adilla, no dalil, we've now made a fool of ourselves, now we want to fall back on what the scholars are doing. Which scholars are we talking about exactly? Who exactly? Ahlul Sunnah, Ahlul Ilm, Ikhwan, they've dealt with and discussed the issue. It is an issue that is muntahiya. And when the ruling came down fairly recently, as our scholars have mentioned, bidalika tantahi fitnatuhu. With this ruling now, and it is something that is sad, Ikhwan, for us particularly, in that he was our sheikh. And this is the issue, and it is ironic that some people say, they're only because, Sheikh Muhammad bin Hadi is the only individual that we have over four tazkiyat from. No other alim, we have tazkiyat from other scholars. But Sheikh Muhammad bin Hadi, I have two written for in my name. Alongside some recorded tazkiyat, that is Tilmizi. My student, if there was anybody that would want to keep him up, then it would have been us. Because of these tazkiyat, and if he falls and all of these tazkiyat fall, if there's anyone that would want to keep him propped up and keep this issue يعني, in the realms of, oh, it's just an issue of khilaf, then it would have been us, Ikhwan. I said to some of the brothers, Yahi, we made mulazama of Muhammad bin Hadi from 93 to 2004. Mulazama. Durus. I'm talking every durus. I said, Yahi, I informed some of the brothers, we could describe his toes to you. Wallahi, and I'm not even kidding. We could describe his toes to you. Because of the mulazama. Kunna nuhibbuhu hubban shadida. But the haq, ayyuhal ikhwa, is dalatul mu'min. And ahlul sunnah, if that was the case, ikhwan, then we would have clung on to the likes of Abdullah Faisal because he's Jamaican. And Bilal Phillips because he's Jamaican. We would have kept him up. He's one of us. What do you mean he's got a problem? No. No. And we would have kept him propped up. But our issue, ikhwan, is haq. Our issue is haq and batil. And if it is, as painful as it may have been, if it is, that someone who was from our teachers, he falls into that which opposes the haq. And he is now, and has now become, the biggest weapon against Ahlul Sunnah in this era. Farraka Ahlul Sunnah, split Ahlul Sunnah, and turn them into a furqa, a firqa. يعني جعل فرقة وفرقة. He has made أهل السنة a فرقة, a group, a sect, by referring to them as سعافقة, spoken against over 77 of them, which is why Sheikh Rabi'i mentioned that they are worse than Haddadiyya. Mahmud Haddad himself, forget about Falih, forget about Hajuri, Mahmud Haddad himself never spoke against 77 of أهل السنة. Spoke against An-Nawawi, Hafid ibn Hajar, Shawkani, Zahabi, individuals. 77? Then nobody. This firqa that we've now seen now being created from Ahlul Sunnah, who? From among the, not even Hajuri created a firqa. Name them. And the furqa that we've seen, the split that we've seen across the globe, billahi alaykum, ma'ashar Ahlul Sunnah, anybody who has been Salafi for 10 to 15 or 20 years, please tell me a fitna that was greater than this. Please tell me a splitting among Ahlul Sunnah that has been greater and of bigger effect than this. Just one. One fitna. Bigger than this. And we're not supposed to have, we're not supposed to be passionate yaqi about this and take a clear position and stand with Ahlul Sunnah against dhulm and against oppression. And you're going to tell me, well, the scholars are different, or it's an issue of difference. And you're going to tell me, well, some people are supporting him, or this one is, yaqi, haq and batil is our issue. Wherever the haq is, we will stand with it. And if you believe that he's upon the haq, billahi alaykum, jiblil adilla, bring for us the adilla, because he's unable to establish it. Bring for us the adilla that makes those who are being referred to as sa'afiqa ahlul balala, people of batil and balala that should be warned against and that we shouldn't sit with or take from. Just jib them for we, and we'll be with you on it. We'll hold a position as well. We'll start durus and lectures, and we'll write some articles and spread them across the globe. We'll do that with you. But if you're not able to establish that, and you will not, then fear Allah Azza wa Jal and take the advice of our Mashaykh al-Kibar, those who have not been sharper in their aql and their perception and their far sight than they are today. Shi'tum am abaytum, regardless of what these people are trying to say. Take their advice. If you don't understand the issue, then yaqi, don't rely upon your own warped faham, naqis faham. Stick and cling to those whose faham and whose sight and whose vision remains sharp, ikhwan. Stick to them. Yani, doubt your own opinion. But we see, ikhwan, and it's unfortunate, people who have no idea and no clue in relation to the issue, believing that they've understood it. We had a sitting and a gathering with some of the brothers in Birmingham fairly recently. And we're dealing with some brothers who have been following some of the WhatsApp and some of the bits and bobs. We said, yaqi, ikhwan, yaqi, first and foremost, Muhammad bin Hadi, we've sat with him on four separate occasions on this issue. Four. Particularly on this issue. The last sitting that I personally had with him, it was myself, Muhammad bin Hadi, Abu Usam al-Khoury, and some lamb and rice. And all of the papers that were supposed to be evidences. Wallahi al-Azim. Those papers that were supposed to be evidences. In a closed sitting. Me, Muhammad bin Hadi, Abu Usama al-Khoury. His right-hand man right now. And Abdul Ilah al-Lahmami. Bas. Four separate occasions. Thereon after, we had a sitting with all of those who are referred to or being referred to as Sa'afiqa. Al-Sheikh Arafat Muhammadi, Al-Sheikh Bandar Khaybari, Al-Sheikh Abdul Ila Al-Juhani, Al-Sheikh Abdul Wahid Al-Madkhali, Al-Sheikh Abdul Mu'ti, Al-Sheikh Muhannad, Al-Sheikh Abdullah Al-Bukhari, Al-Sheikh Abdullah Al-Zafiri. All of them present. We sat till about 3 or 4 in the morning discussing this particular issue. 3 or 4 in the morning. Any issue that we had, we raised it, it was dealt with, and it was responded to. Till 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning in the desert. With another plate of rice and with another plate of meat. Till 4 o'clock in the morning. Sheikh Ana, Sheikh Rabi'i sat with him up on the issue, separate occasions, various separate occasions. The first one to inform us about the issue was Sheikh Ana, Sheikh Ubaid. Informed us concerning the issue, and it was a difficult pill to swallow initially, because it was brand new for us. Then Arafat informed us of the fact that when he had heard of the news, he went to Muhammad bin Hadi and said, "Ya Sheikh, it's reached me that you're speaking about me. Arafat Shar. Arafat Shar." And so, what is the issue, Ya Sheikh? Sheikh said, "Shuft Unais." He said, "You see Anas, which is the son of the Sheikh. He has Anas and Unais. Shuft Anas." He said, "You and Anas is like this." And he rubbed his two index fingers together. "Illa annak akbar min." Except you're older than him. And so he left believing, alhamdulillah, it's kullu kadib. They're all lying. You and Anas is the same, khalas. Then he left, Arafat sir. After he said, "Listen, Sheikh, just explain to me what are the issues." Sheikh Abdullah Bukhari went to him and said, "Listen, these shabab, they come to me. And so if they are upon shar, bayinli, what's the type of shar? What is the shar? Explain it to me." And so he said, "Fasirha ant kama shi't." That was a marra ula. Nata'asha. He said, "The marra thani, a second time, you explain it as you like. Explain it with whatever you want." He said, "Shar is of types. Shar of shirk, shar of kufr, shar of bid'ah, various types of shurur. What shar is it? Fasirha kama shi't ant. You explain it and interpret it as you wish." فين النصيحة؟ That's the kalam of أهل العلم بالله عليكم. That's the kalam عالم. يعني our mashaykh, what we're acquainted with is there is an issue with someone, the issue is raised, the evidences of the issue are presented. وصلى الله على نبينا محمد. ليس كذلك. But now فسرها كما شئت وواوا إلى آخره. Then when the time for him to come from his silence and he made that lecture occurred, there was nothing about Arafat whatsoever. Then what issued after that, and this is something you need to pay attention to, what issued after that from so-called evidences were all issues, ayyuhal ikhwa, that occurred after the fact, the majority of them. That is to say, when you say Arafat Shar, the evidences that we're seeking should predate this statement of yours. Then we're expecting something before the statement, you making the statement. We don't want to now look at tweets that came after this statement, because that is not therefore and cannot possibly be the evidence that you built your statement upon. Your evidence or your statement must be built upon evidences that predate your jarh. That is, you already have evidences indicating that there is an issue. طيب فينها. Where are they? And so all of these affairs, ikhwan, are what has led to our mashaykh and our scholars saying that he has no evidence. He persists upon his position. He arrogantly persists upon the position, knowing that those who are senior to him have warned him, have sat with him, have sought from him to present evidence. And then when a jahil writes an article which is filled with jahil and kadhib, and misconstrued statements and kalam, he writes a muqaddimah. He said, "I've read this, mashallah, and these are the evidences." Wallahi, these are the evidences that indicate. And then they say there are no evidences, he said in this introduction. And then they say there are no evidences. But again, ikhwan, the evidences must predate the statement itself. And there are no evidences, ayyuhal ikhwa, that if it were a case, wallahi, if it were the case, that after he had made the statement, even after he did the lecture and realized that he went too far and accused the man of zina, and they're now saying, no, what he meant by that was he's just an evildoer. But kalimat ahir is one of the clearest of the kalimat, one of the clearest of the words that are used for fornicator. Then they go on to say, well, no. Some of Ahlul Ilm, they say that Ahir is used for a person, yani who is known for fisk, who is known for evil. But what is it that he said? He said, min afjarin nasi fil a'rad. So couple ahir with this statement. From the worst of the people with the private parts. And with the people's yani honors. From the worst of them. So how are we going to still say, oh, he only meant that he's an evildoer. A man who visits bars and pubs and clubs in a lecture. In a lecture. And so the issue was raised against him. And so, in conclusion,
like in Fasir, Limada, why did he start to speak against Abu Yu, where he used to defend him before, and in Qalb, Limada?
Lesh, why? Is the issue. Because, exactly, because he was attempting to use a bayan, there was a bayan that the people of Holland had put out. تستمر
هو لأنك أني أنا تفضل لا يوضح الحمد لله
لا تفضل
إسناد هذه البيان I'll mention it. Just to add on to this part that our brother mentioned, I know it's gone on for long, and I can see some people at the back already getting up. I don't know if you've already prayed Isha Mahdhuratan, like in this Amr Muhim Jiddan. Like I said, I just want to add on this point because I know it's long, but I don't want you to misunderstand here and think that, subhanAllah, it's joy and laughter for us to mention these words. Wallahi, Sheikh Rabi said, he was the most beloved person to me, more than my own sons. And I say as well, wallahi, he was beloved to us. It breaks my heart to hear this. It breaks my heart to have to speak the reality regarding someone who I loved dearly. Wallahi, it breaks the heart. We loved him like how we loved Sheikh Ahmed al-Najmi. We loved him like how we loved Sheikh Zayd al-Madkhali. Lakin, what can we do? We've been commanded to follow the truth and to make the truth manifest and to help the one who was mazloom. The reason why he came out of his silence, the reason why he made and did that talk, right? Because prior to this he was saying, Arafat Shar, he's evil. And one of the main things that he was saying, that I've got Adilla which is going to come out. And then one of the proofs that did come out that he was using, that he causes facade in different countries. And the facade which he caused in Holland. And what was the facade that he caused in Holland? That the brothers got together and wrote a bayan to say that Abu Ayyub will no longer be involved in the affairs of Dawah. He will step down. So Muhammad bin Hadi, when he spoke to Abu Ayyub, he said they shouldn't have done it. They shouldn't have done it and welcomed him and he was okay. There was no problem with Abu Ayyub and Sheikh Muhammad bin Hadi. This is an ironic thing. He actually said what they did by putting this bayan was wrong. Wallahi, Sheikh Muhammad at that time said that this was wrong and he was actually with Abu Ayyub. And they shouldn't have done it. And then what was the problem? The cause of this bayan coming out. I told the brothers not to do it, but it was Arafat. Arafat is the one that told them, and look at the evil and the facade that came from this bayan. So this got spread. And this is one of the things he was using when we sat with him and he was saying, Arafat Shar, look what he does. He causes facade and corruption in different countries. Look what he's done. I told him not to put the bayan out and Arafat told them. So then what happened then? The one that wrote the bayan, Bushta and the other brothers put out a bayan, put out a clarification to say, La, it wasn't Arafat that told us to do it, Ya Sheikh. It wasn't Arafat. When that came out, that caused the first problem. Because that was what you was using as the main evidence. And then he brought out and said that Bushta is the one that told him. The ishara that he made was mafhum and understood that it was Arafat. Then he went to one step further and said Abu Ayyub came and he cried in front of me. And he said that Arafat, yes, Sheikh, was the one that told to put the bayan out. So when Abu Ayyub heard this, Abu Ayyub likewise then wrote, and with ihtiram, saying that maybe it's waham from the Sheikh, making excuses for him, but I did not say that. And if the Sheikh wants to go and have a mustamir and saying it's adamant that I said this, then wallah, I'm ready to sit at Sheikh Rabi's house and have a muba'ila with him, if he wants that. Once that was established, that enraged Sheikh Muhammad bin Hadi. And that's when Sheikh Muhammad bin Hadi came out in the masjid. Sheikh Abdullah Zafiri, what was his problem? Sheikh Abdullah Zafiri was likewise close to Sheikh Muhammad. But Sheikh Muhammad adapted a manhaj. If you're with me, khair. If you're not, ma'as salama. So when Sheikh Abdullah the Fairy came, he was going to have a daughter in Hafr al-Batin. They was going to have a daughter and they was going to invite Sheikh Abdullah Najmi and Sheikh Ali Haddadi and Sheikh Muhammad Akur. Sheikh Muhammad bin Hadi, after sitting with Sheikh Abdullah the Fairy, not agreeing with his mawqif, saying, do not involve yourself with the Sa'afika, he said, yeah, Sheikh, give me the Dalil. Because no Dalil was done, Sheikh Abdullah the Fairy has a problem with him now. So we called Ahl al-Samata and told them not to attend the Dora. So then Sheikh Abdullah the Fairy went to Sheikh Rabi and informed him, yeah, Sheikh Rabi, look what's taking place. Then Sheikh Rabi is the one that called Sheikh Muhammad Akur and Abdullah Najmi. Like, what's going on? You should attend the Dora. That likewise enraged Sheikh Muhammad. So a combination of all of this, he came out guns blazing, attacking Sheikh Abdullah the Fairy. Attacking who? Abu Ayyub, who yesterday he was defending. Bushta likewise. And this is the natija that you see today. Wallahi, ikhwa. Wallahi, Allah bears witness. Allah bears witness to what I say. I'm only saying this min bayan al-haq. He was our sheikh and he was beloved. And this is why it hurts when you get today, like as Abu Hakeem said, individuals that just wish to talk about the mas'ala and they don't even know what's really happening. Yet we know with inside, we sat, we heard. We heard the warning of Sheikh Ubaid. We heard the warnings of Fulan. Before it all came out. Wallahi, I'm willing to stand in front of Allah with this. We do not lie. But haq is haq. After all of these events, is what led Sheikh Muhammad to be in the situation he is now. He came out, and then he started to warn, started to say, Fulan is a fornicator. Why? To bring them down to support his case. But he only went against them. Allah musta'an.
What is ironic, Ikhwan, was that immediately after the lecture, the masjid of Muhammad bin Hadi was milyan with the very same people that used to hate Muhammad bin Hadi, Bil'ams. People used to walk, yani, scoff the people of Sunnah for attending the durus of Muhammad bin Hadi. Full of those individuals. All of a sudden now he's become the alim al-Nihrir, wal-Jihbiz, wal-Hafiz Muhammad bin Hadi, ila akhiri dalik. Bil'ams, these were the same people that just yesterday that couldn't stand Muhammad bin Hadi. Why? Because he was from Jama'at Rabi', Jama'at Ubaid, from Jama'at Abdullah al-Bukhari, and so they couldn't stand him. Now that he's against them, who is Hafiz, and he is, mashallah, يعني, the example of Imam Ahmad, and other than that, from the huge statements of exaggeration concerning him. And so it is ajeeb, Ikhwan, that people should now be in their feelings concerning Muhammad bin Hadi and have no clue, number one, about the issue, other than a few WhatsApp messages and a Telegram message here and there. And have no clue concerning the issue itself. If we were to ask them concerning it, they would not be able to explain it and clarify it. But you're going to get upset. If I was to ask you what Muhammad bin Hadi looked like, you wouldn't be able to explain it to me. You wouldn't most likely have seen him. But you're going to get upset. Why? Because the issue is not Muhammad bin Hadi. The issue is Muhammad bin Hadi is nothing but a sebab, an excuse for you to make manifest that which you already had in your chest from dislike and disavowal to Ahlul Sunnah, but you used to sit in the masjid and you had no reason to make it manifest. Now you have a sebab. And then when this one is over, and it will be over, and you will see, Ikhwan, relatively soon, it will pass. When this one is over, then you'll return back to your corner in the masjid, waiting for the next fitna to occur and to appear. We see, Ikhwan, we've seen it for generations, for decades. Those same individuals that had the issue with this one will be the same individuals that will arise in the next. But it is a dars for Ahlul Sunnah. And Allah Azza wa Jalla has mentioned, as our brother Abdul Razaki mentioned, ما كان الله ليظهر المؤمنين على ما أنتم عليه حتى يميز الخبيث من الطيب وما كان الله ليطلعكم على الغيب. So Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions, indeed Allah was not going to leave you upon, or them upon, what you're upon until He distinguishes الخبيث من الطيب, until that which is good is made distinguished from that which is طيب. That which is evil is made distinguished from that which is tayyib. And so these fitan and these trials do nothing, Ikhwan, but purify the ranks and distinguish the people who are sincere and true from those who have issues, ikhwan, in the chest, those who Allah Azza wa Jal has mentioned concerning them, that indeed, هَلْ حَسِبَ الَّذِينَ أَمْ حَسِبَ الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ أَنْ لَنْ يُخْرِجَ اللَّهُ أَضْغَانَهُمْ وَلَوْ نَشَاءُ لَأَرَيْنَاكَهُمْ وَلَعَرَفْتَهُمْ بِسِيمَاهُمْ وَلَتَعْرِفَنَّهُمْ فِي لَهْنِ الْقَوْلِ. To those who have ill wills or who have sicknesses in their hearts, do they not believe that Allah will bring forward their ill wills? If we wished, we would have shown them to you and you would have seen them by their signs, but you shall certainly know them from the tones in their speech. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى وفقنا وإياكم لما يحبه ويرضاه. يعني آسفين على الإطالة. يعني we apologize for the lengthy discussion in that regard. But hopefully this will not reoccur. We finish up the topic of إخلاص. وجزاكم الله خير.